Shut. Okay. Okay. Hi, everyone. So thanks, Dave, for the introduction. I need to mention also the fact that this work is so supervised by Katia and Eric, and it's also done in collaboration with Mike de Grandpré, who is a researcher at Montana University. So today I'll be working about the sea ice and about its impact on the carbon cycle. Obviously, you probably all know that the Arctic Ocean is going under drastic changes right now related to climate change, obviously. And sea ice is one of the prominent features that is changing very quickly and quite drastically. And so we need to better understand what is the impact of sea ice on the carbon cycle to better be able to predict how the state of the carbon in the Arctic Ocean will evolve in the future. And to do that, I'll run you through some of the processes that are impacted by sea ice so that we can go into the details later on. It's important to spend a little bit of time on this diagram because everything in the rest of the talk is based basically on that. So let's consider the Arctic Ocean, a water column covered by ice in a seasonal fashion. So in winter, it's fully covered by ice, and in summer, the ice melts and opens the water. And let's go through the seasonal cycle and look at what is the impact of sea ice on that. So first, in summer, during the open water season, the PCO2 at the surface of the ocean is relatively low because we have melted a lot of ice before. And so that allows for high CO2 uptake, as is shown by this arrow going down. So the CO2 goes from the atmosphere into the ocean. Then ice starts to form, it freezes. And that leads to a concentration of alkalinity and DIC in the water. We first consider that the sea ice is purely fresh water. And I'll come back to that later on. But let's consider that the ice formation is simply removing fresh water out of the water column. That leads to a concentration of salinity and carbonate properties in the water. And so that leads to an increase in PCO2. And then that reduces the CO2 uptake, basically. And so we have an arrow here, which is slightly smaller than the previous. Then ice fully forms and totally blocks any exchange between the atmosphere and the ocean. So the PCO2 keeps increasing because the ice keeps thickening and so forming, but there's no potential exchange with the atmosphere anymore. Then spring comes, and with that, the ice melts, and that leads to basically an input of fresh water, and so that dilutes alkalinity and DIC in the water, that decreases PCO2, that leads to a high CO2 uptake, and we're back to the open water system. So that's if seawater is considered as being pure fresh water. And that's the case in most climate models, if not all of the CMIP, at least that I know of. But it's not exactly true. I mean, sea ice is not pure fresh water. It contains a little bit of salinity, and also, very importantly, a little bit of alkalinity and DIC, which is basically carbon properties. And so if we do take that into account, here what's happening. During the ice formation, the ice kind of traps alkalinity and DIC, and it traps more alkalinity than DIC. That leads to a further increase of PCO2. I don't have to go through the steps, but trust me, it leads to further increase of PCO2. And so even lower CO2 uptake, as you can see with this even smaller arrow. And then during the ice melt, we're releasing this excess of alkalinity compared to DIC, which goes from the ice to the ocean, and that leads to a further decrease of PCO2. So it adds up to the effect of the dilution. And that leads to a higher CO2 uptake. And so you have anomalous, basically, gases. During the ice melting and the open water seasons, we have more uptake than if we do not account for carbon storage in ice. And during the ice formation season, we have an anomalous outgassing, basically. But this season is pretty short because quickly the ice covers, like blocks any interaction with the atmosphere. Okay, so that's basically the big picture. Let's try to dig a little bit more into the motivation. So basically, this is an emerging field of research. There's been a few observations over the past decade or so, looking at DIC and alkalinity concentration in the sea ice, But it's something that is not implemented in climate models, as I've already mentioned. So that leads to two main questions that I'd like to try to answer. The first one is, how does the storage of APNJC in ice impact the carbon cycle in the Arctic Ocean? And I've already started to pinpoint a little bit some of the aspects of it. And the second question is, are climate models underestimating the CO2 uptake in the Arctic Ocean? To try to answer those questions, I'm using different tools. I'm using a 3D models that cover the Arctic and North Atlantic and Pacific oceans, and which represents, which models the ocean, the ice, and the biology. And I'm using this 3D model to force a 1D model, which does not have any ice components, but I'm parameterizing the ice, basically. And then I'm validating this 1D model with some observations of modern data and ITP, but I won't talk about that at all today. Very briefly, my 1D, the way I parameterize the ice impact onto my 1D model is using this very simple equation. I'm changing the GAC and alkalinity at the surface of my water column by introducing this term, which is basically the freezing melting flux, also called the ice formation rate. So how much fresh water is removed or added to the water column when the ice is freezing or melting. And I multiply that by a concentration of GAC or alkalinity into the ice, which is a simple parameter that I keep constant and like I can choose and so play with it. To better understand a little bit what is the impact, so let's go through a few runs. The idea is that with a 1D model, I can turn on and off some of the parameters. So here in this plot, it's a bit complicated, but at the top you have the ice concentration, basically, so that gives you just an idea of when the ice is fully covering the water column or not. And then in the main panel, on the background color, you have the freezing melting flux. So when it's blue, we are melting ice, we are adding fresh water to water. When it's red, we're freezing, so we move it. The black line is the atmospheric PCO2. It's always the same in all my runs. The red line here is the PCO2 at the surface of the water column, inside the ocean, right? But at the surface. And it's showing a case where there's no impact whatsoever of the ice, not even dilution or concentration of the ice. Then I can add this phenomenon, this dilution and concentration, and you get this purple line. And you can see that the PCO2 is increasing during the freezing period and decreasing a bit more drastically than without it in the melting period. And so that black line would be representative of what is going on in climate models in general. They do account for the dilution concentration, but that's fine. Now let's plug my carbon storage in ice. And so I've taken a parameter, an alkalinity to GAC ratio in ice of 1.8. I'll go back later on to why the alkalinity to GAC ratio is important. But what you can really notice here is that during the freezing season, this light blue line is clearly way higher. So the PCO2 increases faster during the freezing period, and then during the melt period, it decreases faster. And remember that when there's ice, there's no potential exchange with the atmosphere. So when we have a higher PCO2, we do not have exchange because that's when the ice is fully covering the water column. And when we have a lower PCO2 than normal, that's when we're allowing for uptake, and that's what you get here, basically. We can change the alkalinity to GAC ratio parameter just to look at what is going on. And so if I take a slightly lower ratio, you can see that this dark blue line does not have as high an amplitude as a light blue line, but it's still higher than the purple line, which is without any carbon emissions. So basically, to summarize this slide, the carbon storage in ice amplifies the amplitude of the PCO2 signal cycle in a way that the PCO2 is lower when any uptake is possible. Let's go through some equations to run a little bit more into the details of it. So let's go for the fact. The atmosphere to ocean CO2 flux is represented by this equation. It's you've probably seen that in a chemical oceanography. So it's the product of a gas velocity, a solubility of CO2 in the water, and the difference in PCO2 between the atmosphere and the ocean. And then I have to add this impact of ice concentration on the flux. So that's why you have this 1 minus ice. we don't even think about it, but it is important and it is in all the climate models. The gas velocity often is represented as a function of the quadratic speed of, the quadratic wind speed. But you can notice here that I'm not even doing this assumption. This gas velocity can depend on whatever you want. The derivation I'll be doing later on is still robust. So it can even depend on the wave slope or anything like that. There's no issue with the rest of it. Okay, let's now try to compare two worlds. A control one, which is basically a run without any carbon in ice, that would represent a climate model run. And I can compare that to an experiment run where I do implement my parameterization of carbon in sea ice. And so if you do the comparison between both, so the difference between my experiment run and my control run in terms of fluxes, at each time step, I get this. And if I jump a few steps, considering that the PCO2, the atmospheric PCO2 is the same in the two runs, I end up with the gas velocity and the solubility and the ice concentration parameter being factorized. And so inside, I just end up with the difference in PCO2 in the water between the two runs. So this is true for each time step. But I'm interested over a full seasonal cycle, right? So let's integrate this difference over a year, and let's split this year between a freezing period and a melting period. So I can definitely do that because it's a simple properties of the integral. And one thing to notice is that during the freezing period, the ice concentration is often very close to one. You can, if you're not convinced of that, you can simply look at this plot. You can see that the ice concentration jumps back to 100% whenever the freezing melting flux is going back to negative values. And that's you know, roughly always true. So this integral of the freezing, like what is inside this integral, will be equal to zero because one minus ice concentration will be equal to zero. So we end up with just the integral over the melting period. And inside this integral, there's this delta PCO2. We can go a little bit further than that. We can try to expand this delta using a method that Takahashi and colleagues did in a paper from 1993, where they expanded a simple mathematical expansion of PCO2 along its different variables. And I'll be considering that temperature and salinity do not impact PCO2 because it's the same in my two runs. Remember that I'm just comparing two different runs where the only difference is carbon storage in ice. Temperature and salinity will be the same. I will take some of the values that Takahashi is giving for polar regions as approximations. And I end up with, while jumping a few steps, I end up with this expression where I have here the freezing melting flux, some other terms, I won't go into the details of those. And then I have, in front of all those, I have this linear function of the alkalinity to DIC ratio in ice. That's where it comes from. Remember, I about this alkalinity to DIC ratio earlier. This is a constant, this 12.5, and the 14 is also a constant. The alkalinity to DIC ratio in my parameter tradition is constant for each one. And so what you can easily notice is that if my alkalinity to DIC ratio is close to 1.12, this whole term is equal to zero. And so my whole delta PCO2 is equal to zero. And therefore my whole integral will be equal to zero. Remember that, it will come up, I'll come back to that later. But basically, so all of that is constant through time, so we can take it out of the integral in a way. And so we end up with a difference for my integral over the full year, a difference between my two runs, which is supposed to be a linear function of my alkalinity to DIC ratio, according to this mathematical formulation. Is it really true? Well, I can easily check that with my 1D model. And I can do a bunch of runs, a few hundred of runs, using different values for the alkalinity and DIC in ice, and not changing anything else. So the forcings are the same, the initial conditions are the same, and so on. I just change the alkalinity and the DIC values in ice, and then I calculate, I launch my runs, and I calculate the net CO2 uptake over the full run, which is what you see in the background color. And I can put on top of that, as white lines, the alkalinity to DIC ratio. And you can clearly see that when this ratio increases, so does the net CO2 uptake. So that kind of shows that the derivation we did earlier kind of seemed pretty right. And if you're not convinced of that, just look at this control line, this black line. This is the line, the value for the net CO2 uptake if I do not turn on my carbon in ice parameterization. So that would be a control error, basically. And you can notice that it's very close to this 1.1 value. It's not exactly the same because I did some approximation. Well, Takahashi and colleagues did some approximation with 12.5 and 14 ratio, but it's pretty close to it. So that, to me, that's another element that kind of shows that my derivation is robust. So the impact of carbon storage in sea ice on the CO2 uptake is basically driven by this alkalinity to DIC ratio. The issue is that this ratio is poorly constrained. Observations cover a wide range of values, and it's also varying over time. So that's one of the uncertainties. But if we can pinpoint a bit better this value, then we would have a better estimate on what would be the impact of carbon storage. So if I go back to my earlier scientific question, the first one is, how does the storage of alkalinity and DIC in ice impact the carbon cycle in the Arctic Ocean? Well, it amplifies the PCO2 seasonal cycle by decreasing it, decreasing the PCO2 values during the melt season, which is a season when we have exchange with the atmosphere. And so overall, it will increase the net CO2 uptake. And the second question is, are climate models underestimating the CO2 uptake in the Arctic Ocean? And obviously, that's work in progress. We have some elements to think that the answer to this question is yes, but stay tuned if you want more on this. Thank you very much.
Great, thanks, Ben. Are there any questions out there? Anybody?
Can I ask a question?
Go for it.
Yeah, it's Dan Kelly. I'm not sure if my video's up. It doesn't matter. I had a question about the effect of ice on waves, because I think waves are pretty important in the air-sea exchanges of gases. So did you want to comment on that?
I'm not looking at that, unfortunately, so I don't know. I think, I guess the right person to ask to ask this question to is Jean-Pierre, because he's working on that. I look at regional models, so I do not represent waves, for example, in my model. And therefore, I don't know exactly what would be the impact of ice on waves.
Right,
but
thank you.
I do suspect there would be some interest are important for the best.
Doug, you have a question?
Yeah, quick one. I can see that in the scenario where you've got the seasonal cycle with respiration underneath the ice in winter and productivity in summer, and the balance is very delicate between, when you have ice melt, which can cap ice melt water, which can cap a lot of the surface water from being able to exchange CO2 with the atmosphere versus, it's a pretty delicate balance. So I'm just wondering how much detail are you going into what I think in the literature, we've called it a seasonal rectification hypothesis, where you have the potential for the respiration in winter not to be able to outgas because of both uptake in the summer, but also the injection of ice melt water, which caps a large part of the surface water. So how much detail are you going to go look into this, Benjamin, in the 1D model, I'm wondering?
Well, it's not clear yet. We don't know yet. It will depend on our findings, but that's definitely something we are trying to look into. There's even more processes than the biology. There's also the brine rejection that could potentially make carbon sink below the mixed layer. There's many processes that could that are linked together. So that's a very good question. And obviously, I don't know yet to which detail, level of details will go. But if we can try to pinpoint that a little bit, that would be that's the goal. I'll just mention the fact that in my derivations, using especially the Takahashi expression, I think if I do account for the biology in the same way in the two runs, and if we discard any nonlinear effects, the biology will act on the same way in the two runs. And so therefore, if we just look at the impact of the carbon storage in ice and how it impacts estimates from climate models, biology shouldn't have any impact on this value that we end up with, basically. I don't know if that answers your question, but, and I don't know if I'm really clear.
Well, it does, and I mean, it's really interesting. I mean, yes, it shouldn't, but it might, right? Anyway, no, it's really, now just my personal feeling is that, you know, this exploration of this role of ice is, as you point out, it's already quite complex, even with some simplifications, and it's really kind of would be really good for us a kind of a combined modeling and observational study in a simple system, whatever a simple system might be. Yeah, anyway, very interesting. Thanks.